And then, what's up, everybody? Peter Martin here. Welcome, welcome. I'm so excited to welcome Mr. Sean Jones. How you doing, Sean?
What's up, everybody? I'm great. How you feel?
I feel good, and I hope everybody feels good. It's excited. I'm excited to see you, and I've been seeing you only online. Can't wait to see you in person, play together, hang together, maybe even have a drink together, but we got to do it virtually for now. So, you know, that's how we do it, right?
All of that.
That's right, right. So we are going to keep it loose as we always do. And if you guys have questions for Sean, if we have time, we're going to get to all that. But I thought it would be cool to just kind of catch up on what you've been doing and what's been going on, kind of where your mindset is, because you've always got such great insights into what's happening now, what was happening, and what's going to be happening, you know? So
yeah.
Can you kind of catch us up for those that haven't been closely knowing your whereabouts and what's been going on?
Well, it's been a lot on a personal level. I have a newborn. So that's been pretty amazing in that I get the chance to be at home. Normally I'd be on the road and I'd have to Skype in, but I get to see her every day and watch her grow up every day. And it's been amazing, man. So it's been kind of a blessing. Now regarding work, I face a lot of the same challenges that everyone else has. And that those challenges being, how do you create? How do you find synergies with the members of the band and different bands that you've been working with? How do you supplement that level of income that is now dipped away? What I mean by income is the income that comes with live performance. Those are gigs.
Yeah.
How do you supplement that? What does that look like?
I'm glad you reminded us all, but the word gigs, we got to keep saying that so we remember what they are.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And, you know, just remaining inspired during this time and not falling into a place of pessimism. I think it's important that artists tell the truth, but also all sides of it. Like, what are the pros of this time? What are we learning from this time? What should we not repeat during this time? All of those kinds of things. And that's mainly my focus right now, man. And I'm sure that's the focus for the vast majority of folks that are out there.
Man, absolutely. And, you know, one thing on the positive side that I've been able to do is kind of catch up with, you know, all my friends that are happen to be great artists like yourself in this format, but also just like looking at it was Miles's birthday yesterday, and I was looking at your Instagram story. You did such a cool thing with a series of LPs. It was just like no words. It was just LP, and like you were holding them in a brick wall there. LP, a mandala, Miles Smiles, you know, Nefertiti. And I mean, it was just it's such a just kind of to slow down and appreciate and share these moments and stuff. I mean, we definitely do it on the road and on the gig. It's a different kind of pace, but you know, I've noticed as we've talked that, you know, you've been really finding some great ways, as you say, to stay inspired, but also to kind of look at things in a little bit of a different light and to be like, okay, well, we don't have this. What do we have? And yeah. I know you've continued doing a lot of teaching during this period. Have you been able to kind of, you know, infuse your teaching and pass that along to the students? Cause I'm sure they're kind of like, what's going on? What am I doing?
For sure. I'm in contact with my students all the time. Not just about music and grades and stuff like that, man, but just making sure that they're cool. In any leadership position or a position of apprenticeship, if you will, I feel that it's my job to take care of everybody else first. And that's kind of how I operate. I want to make sure my students are cool. I'm going to be all right. I have perspective, you know, I find my way to get through. But I worry about younger people who have never seen this before, who are worried about going into music in general. And I just remind them that the world has been there before. And we always need the arts. We need artists to do their thing. So I would remind people to just stay fast and keep moving. Not just for my students, but you know, family and friends in general. We got to hold each other up, you know.
Yeah, that's, and it's so important to, you know, for the students being younger and never seen something like this. If they see us all freaking out, like the world's ending, we're never going to play again. They're like, man, I was just getting my scales together where I might've been able to get a gig. Now, it's not even competing for the gig. Right. But I think that, you know, this idea that, I mean, music is important. Ballet is important. Like these things, you know, it was almost like for me at first, you want to back away because you feel like, oh, okay, this is such a discretionary thing that we do, you know, first responders and doctors. And of course that's important, but then you see people looking to us to interpret the world. They're like, help. Like we rely on arts to interpret the world.
Man, I just want to say we're just as valuable. Now we're not directly, maybe I shouldn't use the word valuable. I would say needed. Obviously you need first responders. You need people that you can call to go in emergency settings. Yeah. And God bless those folks. You know what I mean? We need them. But let's be real here. Most of the world that is not sick, that's looking for somewhere to go, they're going to entertainment.
Right.
They're looking for the artists. They're looking for the visual artists. They're looking for the sound. They're looking for all of that. They're looking for new recipes, culinary arts.
Yep.
You know, someone said, you know, what would life be without the poets? Mm. What would life be without the arts? Where would people turn? And so I think that we're responsible in this time now for a certain level of mental sanity. Mm. Like just to be there all the way and just give people an escape and give people the ability to face the reality, you know, without going crazy. So while I understand, yes, of course, all of those folks, those fire people, those first responders, people that are in the hospitals doing the thing, I wouldn't want to do that. No, that's extremely difficult. But I think that at the end of the day, you know, my job is to take care of that person that's in the house all by themselves. That needs some music, that needs something that's going crazy. You know, my job is to present the song. And so that's how I feel about that.
Man, it's so true. And that's, to me, that's really what community is about. It's like these crisis moments, it clarifies like where we fit into the community and the value and the worth. And even above that, kind of our duty. You know, like we got to be ready to soothe people when like, what's going on? to play that beautiful melody, to sing that lyric, to have the recipe, like you say, you know, because the world needs us not less than, you know, during a crisis, actually is more, you know,
for sure.
And I think that, you know, one of the kind of silver linings of this whole situation for me has been all the feedback from our Open Studio students for your guys' courses, you and McBride and Dianne Reeves and Peter Sprague and all the stuff that, you know, some of the stuff you recorded a few years ago and, you know, you finish a lesson and then you move on. But people have had time to like, wow, I want to work on my jazz trumpet. I mean, I'm not working or I'm at home for a while. And we've had a flood of people come in and the comments we get and the message where they're like, wow, I finally had time to like really sit down. I had Sean's course, but I just never had time. Man, it changed my life. I got this fingering thing together, you know, and it doesn't matter if it's like the highest level of music or just like the trumpet nerd stuff. I mean, we're getting all these comments and people connecting in a way that's so gratifying because it's bringing them. I mean, you know, it's nothing like we can sit and play our instruments, but these are people that are improving at a rate we'd love to improve at. Like we improved at that rate when we were younger. And I think it's been a very special time for them and getting to know some of them and see that progress. Because, you know, some people, I guess, just are like, oh, I got time. I'm just going to watch Netflix all day, you know?
Yeah. I mean, everybody has their way of coping and everybody has their time. But if I would encourage folks to take this time to do a few different things. One, what's up, Bernadine Dorsey? How you doing? I see y'all over there. Also, my man Gary got a question. I'm gonna get to y'all. Good to see y'all. But I would suggest doing a few things during this time. Look at reinventing yourself. Mm. Look at the things that you've always avoided doing. And you said the number one excuse is I don't have the time.
Yep.
Chances are you have, if not more time now, a different version of time. Mm. And sometimes that's what's needed. Not necessarily more time, but a lack of a schedule or a lack of this happening this way.
Yeah.
Another thing I would suggest doing during this time is just kind of just not caring what anybody thinks, in a way. Like trying some stuff that is like, oh, that's so silly, or I shouldn't do that. Well, you're at home now. Chances are you're at home, not a whole lot to do. You can't get together with your friends or project your image of yourself. So why not be the image that of yourself that you always wanted to be? Why not be that? So those are just a few things to check out.
I love that. And I think, you know, this thing of, it's almost like getting lost in the time. You know, we were talking earlier before we came on air about like what day of the week it is and stuff. That sometimes is the perfect setting to practice. You know, like when you get to that deep shed where like everything's flowing and you're like, you don't know if a half hour went by, if it was 4 hours, you know, and like this is a great time for that, because you may not have somewhere to go and you can make a lot of progress. And I mean, there's nothing like making progress when you're not even looking at the clock. I bet that's a beautiful thing.
That's true, man.
Yeah. So I just wanted, before we get to, we got some great questions and stuff. Before we get to that, I wanted just to mention one thing, because you were talking about your students, and I was trying to find this thing I had just read recently. I'm gonna go back to the archives a little bit, but one thing, Sean, I love about your approach to teaching is like you really go from the most specific, like this is how you tongue, this is like the nuts and bolts, all the way up to the very like, you know, this is how to lead your life. Forget about the trumpet, forget about music. What are your goals? What are your things? And you're such a humble teacher too. And I just wanted to read something. I don't even know if you're going to remember this, but this is from your blog. So you said, couple thoughts on this. You said, had to say this. I just heard, saw a teacher online basically taking credit for a former student's success. Couple thoughts on this. That student would have likely been successful with or without you. You just happened to be a pit stop along the way on that student's journey. I mean, this is so true, but we don't hear that. We definitely don't hear great teachers saying that enough. And it's such a such a profound thing.
Thank you, man. But it's real, you know. You want to have a certain level of pride as an educator, yeah. And you want to pat yourself on the back when something goes right. Now, the reality is, when you're in that classroom and it's one-on-one, or you're in a classroom and it's 1-on-30, chances are you're going to have to repeat what you say a few times. Chances are they're not going to get it. Okay. It's your job to communicate that answer. And over the years, I've realized that everyone just doesn't learn the same way. And it's your job to crack the code as an educator. Mm. And you're lucky if you do. Mm. You're lucky if you do. Sometimes you don't. And in the case that you are not able to, then you have to go on basically an excursion with your students. Let's discover together. Or you lead me. Perhaps you should teach me. And then the real relationship starts to happen. Like, I got to give a shout out to one of my professors, Stephen Gage, who was on here at YSU. I see him. Dr. Gage is one of those folks that if he had the answer, he would give it. If he didn't have it, you'd explore. And it was always positive, you know, and that's what it's supposed to be, especially now. You know, I was so upset about a month or so ago when I saw online that there was a cohort of students that were just inundated with work. They felt like they couldn't make it. They felt that their teachers weren't listening to them. Now is not the time for all of that. Now's the time to discover, to be there for your students, to figure out what they need, to help them discover their artistic endeavors through this crisis. So that's where I am. And any student that goes on to be successful, I will say, you know, on the record, that it's not because of me. Hmm. I'm just thankful that, again, like you said, I'm a pit stop along the way, and I'm thankful that I had the opportunity to work with them.
That's great. And I can tell all of you out there, I never studied with Sean, but I've seen him teach and I've played with him. And Sean, you bring the same, I mean, that's just you. So it's not even about like you're putting on your educator, or your player set. Like that's the way you play. Like we've never even talked about it. Like most musicians don't, in terms of like accompanying and playing different things. You bring that same spirit of, you know, I almost call it like, you know, kind of extreme leadership, where you put everybody else ahead of you, but you're able to lead at the same time. And I've seen you do this with your band and your current iteration is such an amazing group of like, you know, different ages, but everybody come into this, to the spirit of the music under your leadership. But I mean, you are, you're more willing to put the spotlight on them first and the end result of that. I mean, and I was at some of those gigs, the Live at the Bistro album, and to see that live and then hear it captured, you know, you have a real natural, well, I would say a natural knack for leadership, but it's also, I always hate it when people are like, ah, he's a natural leader. It's like, I know that takes work too, though. You know, it's like, ah, he's a natural, you know, he's got a natural 92% free throw. Nobody's born with that. You know, it takes work. Yeah, but it's cool so I'm going to read one other one. You had a bunch of cool things, and you can see this on Sean's blog. If you get a chance, that's actually been fun. I was looking at McBride's got a great blog. I mean, you're a great writer. You're great with lists. You got to get back on your blog. I know how it is. It's like social media kind of messed up the blog game because everybody's like, oh, you got to feed it to me in the Instagram feed. I don't want to go to a blog.
But yeah, that's the blog now.
Yeah. But the thing is, man, we have some great writers and thinkers in jazz right now. And that's another kind of cool thing about this period. I've been getting to catch up on a little bit of, you know, your guys writing and stuff. And it's so cool to see different sides of, it's like actually seeing the same side of you, but seeing it in a different, manifesting it in a different format, a different channel.
Well, you know, man, before you read that, I got an interesting thought about that. Mm-hmm. I actually believe that if you're an artist, if you're an accomplished artist, or if you're an artist that just happens to be out there gigging or whatever, maybe that's not your main thing. I feel that any artist has the ability to go in the other art, other mediums, and at least be somewhat proficient at it, mm-hmm. if they take the time. Because artistry is not about a singular lane. Man. If you can hear, you can see. And if you can see, you can touch. You can touch, you can smell. Now, obviously, you can probably do some of those things better than the other. But for me, I can see a certain thing and want to play it. And then after I play it, I want to taste it. Mm. And then after I taste it, I want to see it. And like, I want all of those things. That's art. And I think oftentimes, or too often, we get caught up in this singular lane of what we do that we forget that we got to kind of make it all coincide here. And that's what the art and being a human being is all about to me.
Absolutely, man. It's such a great holistic approach to art. You know, it's like, where do we fit in? But where can we serve? Where can we serve?
Yeah. And ultimately that is a position of serving, just like leadership. Yep. Leadership is a service position.
Right.
If you're not willing to serve, you should not be a leader.
That's right.
Period. End of discussion.
I know, it's like everybody who's not leading and they look up like, man, I wish I was in that position because then I'd have all the stuff they got. And then when they get there, they're like, wait, I got to do a bunch of stuff for people. Like you think you're going to have a bunch of people doing stuff for you. It's the other way around.
Right. Exactly.
All right. So the other thing I just wanted to touch on that you said, I love this. And I've seen your different iterations on this. Don't seek accolades or awards for stuff you're supposed to do. All caps. You're supposed to do. And yeah. You've got another thing that you've always kind of intertwined in your social media posts, which is hashtag do your job. Yep. And I would put that, I'm taking that as a similar thing, like, you know, do your job because that's what you're supposed to do. And then don't look for praise because you're already doing what you're supposed to do.
Exactly. Man, look, everyone on this planet has been given some kind of gift. Now, I actually cringe at the word gift because gift is like, oh, you're rewarded. It almost sounds like a reward. But the way that I look at gifts is, one, a gift typically is something you don't deserve, but you were given. All right? It's you didn't do anything to achieve that or to gain it. A gift is like, oh, here, right? And with that gift, you have a responsibility to do something with it. When I was growing up, man, again, I say this all the time. I was in church 390 days a year. And man, but there was a scripture that they would say all the time. And that scripture is, for them that knoweth to do and doeth not, it is a sin. Mm. So if you know you're supposed to do something, if you know you're supposed to write a song, if you know you're supposed to teach, if you know you're supposed to do whatever it is, and you don't do it and you make excuses, that is an egregious error and fundamental lack of understanding of your purpose in the world. Now, a lot of people say, well, it's easier said than done. Most of the time, what's necessary and what easy don't coincide. Like, it's important for us to get inside of doing things because it is necessary,
right?
Not because it's easy.
Right, right.
You know?
Well, and I think that's how people look, even if they don't know the ins and outs of what we're doing. They can recognize, you know, people that come to hear music, people that go to see the ballet or a dance or whatever. It's like they're looking for that art being manifested in some way. It's not about us. It's not about, yes, Sean Jones, but we recognize it's like, well, he can play the trumpet, but more importantly, like, he's taken that on his back and be like, okay, I'm going to put that on and I'm going to walk up the mountain with the trumpet and do the best that I can to serve others. So that when you play, it's like, we all enjoy it. You know, we get together and play. It's not about, yeah, we're having fun, but only so that the audience can have fun with us, so that they can enjoy, so that they can be uplifted.
And you also have that, man. I mean, that's why we have the relationship that we have, and other artists like Dianne and McBride, and, you know, I don't want to give the whole open studio roster, but I just have to talk about that roster in particular, because you don't just have great musicians. You have great people on that roster. That's one of the main reasons I wanted to be a part of what y'all are doing, is because, yes, you're talking about the art and how to get to a certain place artistically, but you're also talking about humanity and how we all rise with it. And I love that, man. It's just fantastic, and it's an honor to be a part of something that you've built that's so profound, man, and so needed during this time.
Oh, man, thank you. And likewise, man, an honor to have you. I want to see if I can get this, throw up this picture. Can you see that there? That is... You remember that gig?
I'm looking at my phone and Facebook, so.
Oh, hold on, wait, I gotta pull the comment.
I gotta wait for the
so
wait
this,
for it to come up on the screen.
This was,
hey, shout out to my mom. My mom just chimed in.
Oh, what's up, mom?
Don't start telling people what I look like in diapers. Oh yeah, I do remember that gig, man.
This was Pittsburgh Jazz Festival. Yeah. I want to say like 2007, maybe 2008. And okay, first of all, big shout out to the audience. Horrible social distancing, but you know, that was before that was the thing, so they didn't know. Yeah. But you sat in with us. I think you played like half the set or a third of the set. What, you know, whatever it was killing. But that's such a cool festival there. And you spent some time in Pittsburgh, right?
Yeah, man, I lived in Pittsburgh for 10 years. I started teaching at Duquesne University, excuse me, in 2003. And I moved in 2013, man, to Boston. And I didn't move because I didn't like Pittsburgh. I love Pittsburgh. I basically moved because I got uncomfortable. I got comfortable. And, you know, I received tenure at Duquesne University, and you know, it's like, oh, I've achieved this. Yeah. And upon receiving tenure, man, the first thing I wanted to do was give it up. Yeah. Just because I knew that there was another place to go, another level to achieve. Mm-hmm. And I'm just not one of those folks that like to be, you know, I don't like to be that comfortable. I think that there's always something else to learn. There's always something else to achieve.
Yep. And so, that's a great lesson. I'm sure your students are benefiting from if they're paying attention, because you've done that. I just want to show this picture again. It's such a fun, you know, when we're not doing gigs, it's fun to look at it at least. It's this is a cool perspective, because this is like something none of us ever see. It's like kind of bird's eye from behind. But no, I was just thinking, you've made a habit. That's not just something that you say, what you were just talking about, because you've left gigs, teaching gigs and big gigs, before you needed to, when people were like, damn, why did you, because did you, after Pittsburgh, is that when you went to Berkeley?
Yeah, that's when I went to Berkeley, and it was going well at Berkeley.
Right.
I loved it there, man. I loved the city of Boston, the school city, and I loved teaching at Berkeley, man. I mean, I still say to this day, Berkeley College of Music is the number one contemporary music school in the world. You can't top it in terms of contemporary music.
Right.
Now, that doesn't mean it's for everybody.
Right.
You know, it's a very specific thing that you get there. Yeah. But I was happy there, man. And something opened up in Baltimore at the Peabody Conservatory. They had a position open, and the jazz department was struggling. And I said to myself, you know, I don't want to look back on this 20 years from now and say, you didn't take the opportunity. Even if I fail, you know, at least I can say I tried. I don't ever want in my life to say, okay, Sean, you just backed out of it, or you were too scared to try it. I can't live with that.
Right.
So I left the comfort of Berkeley to go into a situation that I didn't know about. And we've tripled the size of the department in a year and a half. So it's going well. I'm happy.
Well, and it's great too. And you immediately brought in such a strong and you know, varied. Well, the only thing that didn't vary on the faculty was how great all they are as players and teachers, I'm sure as well. But it was a nice mix of, you know, Baltimore and DC kind of connected folks, and then some from beyond that, like yourself. But I know that the buzz about the program has been amazing. You know, folks have to, I guess they got to get into John Hopkins University as well. That's always a challenge, but.
Yeah, it's hard to get into Hopkins. It's very difficult. I think you got to have a 3.0 GPA or something like that. But I always wanted the opportunity to create my own program somewhere, and it to be based around how Bird learned how to play, and how Dizzy learned how to play, and all these cats learned how to play. Yeah, they had some formal training, but they basically learned through the hanging out with each other, standing over cats, like, what is that? What is that chord? What is this vibe? What is that?
Right.
And I created a curriculum to address all of that. So basically the students are hanging all day long with us. Yes, there are formal classes, there's theory and all of that stuff. But let's be real, man, you know this. Once you get theory, you got it.
Right.
I mean, you still keep looking at it, but how many different ways are you going to say C7 on paper?
That's right.
Notice I said on paper.
Right.
How many different ways can you say that?
Right.
What, four? You know what I mean? Different versions. I mean, obviously you orchestrate a different way, but the hang is where you really learn how to play. Mm. That's where you learn how to play. That's where you learn how to create. That's how you figure out who you are as a player. It's not just a classroom. So that's what we're doing here, and I'm excited about it, man.
No, it's great. And you're also one of those musicians that, like almost all, like kind of our generation of jazz players, I would say, are very willing to give the information. You know, it's a little bit the generation before us. And although, you know, I was really the beneficiary here in St. Louis of coming up under some great players that really took me and other young players under their wing and had us. I mean, we just learned by the hang was the gig, you know. It was like, I mean, I was playing with, you know, Willie Akins and stuff, who was like a St. Louis legend. I didn't know what I was doing. And he would just kind of, you know, I would learn by, he'd sort of turn around to me sometimes like, you know, and then I was like, oh, I guess I got to get that part together. But that kind of thing, you know, you at Peabody and then a couple other choice programs that not only have the players but have the teachers that are willing to take the time to pass on that stuff to the next generation, man, it's still happening, which is great.
Yeah, and it's needed now more than ever. I mean, the clubs aren't where the gigs, See, I just want to say to kind of refute something real quick. You know, a lot of people say, oh, there are no more gigs, or there's no gigs out there. That's a lie. Mm-hmm. If that were the case, then people wouldn't be doing this.
Exactly.
There are gigs out there. They're just in different places.
Right.
All right. So no, you don't have the tiny little club anymore all up and down a street in a city. You don't have a bunch of that, but you have performing arts spaces. You have arts presenters. Yep. You have different venues inside of your town that aren't just jazz. They present a lot of artistic things. You have grants that you could write. You have, there's so many different ways to monetize what it is that you do that I just want to refute that notion every single chance I get.
Right.
The reason that people don't make money in the arts is because they don't have business acumen.
Yep.
That's why.
Yep.
It's not exactly. Because you can't make money being an artist.
Right. You know. No, that's so true. When I taught at the Betty Carter Jazz Ahead at Kennedy Center last year, and we're supposed to do it this year. Of course, it's postponed or canceled. But I mean, this is like a group of sort of, you know, really good, just graduated from like Berkeley and New England Conservatory and San Francisco. You know, I mean, like great young players, and some were like as young as 19 or 20, you know, like the players, like this generation's players. And yeah. They knew, I mean, everything, you know, theory, they could play, they knew all the records. The one area that they were most lacking, I would say, is what you were just talking about, the business acumen, like even surprisingly, just sort of the basics of kind of what you need to be a modern musician, I would say. And I was kind of surprised about that. And I'm not sure if I know all these schools are, you know, you have access to this stuff, you know, in different classes, but I guess it's not necessarily required. And so, you know, everybody, as they should be, they're really concentrating on becoming great players, but it's such an important part of it.
Well, the conservatories, different music schools all over the world have realized that that's an issue that has to be addressed. So mm-hmm. You've seen over the past 10 to 15 years, all of these institutions address this by either having a required business course or having some type of track where you have to be in business, mm-hmm. right? So that's been addressed, and it is specifically being addressed at Peabody, in that our students can't graduate without taking those courses.
That's great.
So you're going to know how to put together a resume. Actually, at Peabody, since I've come on, one of the things I wanted to do is make sure the students graduated with the equivalent of an album, so that people know what you sound like. You have these things, the stuff that I wish I knew when I was coming up in school.
Yeah,
is the stuff that I want to teach.
But we couldn't hardly have even done that, even if they had told us I mean, how are we going to put an album together, you know, when we were that age? I mean, maybe would have been harder.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's different. And for me, if my students can't monetize what they do upon graduation and they don't have the tools tools to be able to do that, then I failed as an educator. Hmm. That's how I feel. They should be able to make a living when they graduate.
Right. Yeah, because, I mean, you know, little clubs, big concert. I mean, venues come and go, as we know. What doesn't change and what doesn't leave is people's wanting to hear this music, you know, wanting to hear creative music. And that's a big world, and it's bigger than, you know, when we get caught in the little, like, do you play hard bop? I mean, it's not about, like, creative music. People that want to come. I always think about it like, you know, people like, what kind of music do you play? It's like, I play the kind of music, hopefully, if I'm doing my job right, that the kind of people that want to come to pay money to hear me play are ones that want to hear me play the same song differently each time they come. Like they feel like they're getting their money's worth because it's not what they expected. I kept them on the edge of their seat, you know?
Well, let's be real, man. How many people actually go to a concert or go to something and say, I only want to hear this, or I only want to hear, I mean, I just don't feel that people do that anymore. Like, well, it's Friday night. I got to go hear my classical music. Do people do that? I don't know. Or do they say, I want to hear this band, or I want to hear this person?
Right.
So I think it's important for us as creators to keep that in mind. People want you first. And then if it happens to be classical music or jazz or funk or R&B or whatever it is, whatever it is, then they can call it that.
Right.
But ultimately, people are going to want to hear what you have to say because it's you.
Yeah. And I find like these, you know, sometimes these arguments we get in the jazz world, these real like, this is this, call it this. No, you're not doing this. Like the audience that we do have, they don't care anything about that. I always use Kelly, my wife, as the barometer because she knows a lot about music. I mean, not just since because she's been married to me. I mean, like her dad had a jazz record store in St. Louis. And like, I mean, she came up around me. She's not a musician, but she knows the music. But I always judge like, I'll be like, I can't believe they said this. And when if she's not interested in that, I'm like, oh, it really doesn't matter in the outside world, actually. That's just for us.
we're the only ones that care.
Right.
And I'm not going to say that it's wrong for us to care. I mean, there are cats that are very, you know, emotionally attached to certain things or they're saying like, this should not be the way. We should not call what we do this.
Right.
And I get that. And that's cool. But at the same time, I think we don't want to lose sight of who's actually listening to us and why.
Right, right.
You know.
Yep, absolutely. Okay, so I threw a comment up here just because I was going on my soliloquy about how important your courses are. This is not a plant. This is from Jamil. He says, your course, Volume 1, kicked off 2 months of me getting back to my horn and my dream of playing jazz, something I gave up a long time ago.
Oh, so, that's cool. I'm glad to hear that.
It's real.
Love,
man. Yeah, man. It's real. And that's what it is. That's what I'm saying. It's like a dream, you know, and I think, you know, we've talked about this before. And what, you know, what I love when we get the chance to vibe together is that like, we still have that. We're not jaded. Like every time I've never seen you, Sean, where you're like, oh man. And I mean, we know some good cats. I mean, good players that'll be like, oh man, I'm just trying to, you know, and I'm like, I mean, you still have that dream in your eye. And I know I have that. And I think, you know, really the majority of the really good players have that because we see this as a duty and a blessing and stuff, but it's really no different than Jamil, what you're saying, your dream of play. I got a dream of playing jazz. You know, I'm not like, oh, I can play now. My dream is achieved. You know, every day I get up, I'm like, wow, this is cool to be a part of this, a little part of this lineage and to be able to keep the dream alive.
Oh man, I don't know if you can see behind me, man, but you know, some of my records are behind me. And I just bought a stack. There's a spot in Baltimore here, El Supremo Records. Shout out to my man Jack.
Ooh.
I called Jack up. I said, look, man, you know, what's new in? And he said, okay, give me a day. And he put some stuff together. So
oh man.
You know, I got my new stack. I'm always researching, trying to figure out what to do. And I just want to address one thing that you said, you know, cats that are dark about certain things, we call it being dark or less optimistic, if you will. Man, I heard something when I was a kid that I've just recently, over the past few years of being an adult, what it really means. And the saying is, the common denominator between you and all of your problems is you.
Right. Hello. Hello.
So these cats that are out here dark and this is not. Well, you got to figure out what you're doing wrong. What are you not? What stone have you not turned over? Who have you not reached out to? What skill have you not developed? You know, what business have you not taken care of? If you want to figure out what's going on wrong in your life, the mirror is the perfect place to start. And I'm saying that personally because I have a very close relationship with the mirror. A very close relationship. I'm not afraid to look in there and say, oh, you know, you need to straighten that out or you need to get that together. Because that's what it is. And I'm not afraid to admit when I've done wrong, man. I mean, we all screw up. Or I'm not on the case, or this isn't prepared, or this isn't right. We're human, but you got to be able to look in that mirror and say, okay, I'm dark right now. What's going on in my world that has me dark? And if you're always looking at everybody else and not looking inward, look inward.
Yeah. And I mean, I love, for me, teaching has always been a great, facilitator of that looking in the mirror. Cause you know, sometimes I'll give a lesson or I'll record a video and I'm like, come on, when you're practicing this, make sure you do the contract, you do this, you know, peace. Well, and I know it's right. And then yeah. I kind of look at myself in the mirror. I'm like, wait, have I done that
but that's
in the
last 6 months? That's because you're a grounded cat though, man. You know how many people teach out of their own insecurity? Mm. I mean, bro, I mean, they're like, oh, so now, oh, you can't do that. One of the things that I can't stand for like teachers to do is they'll say, what? You don't know that?
Right, well, right.
No, that's why they're there.
That's why they're there. Exactly. They're paying you to find it out. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, why are you guilt tripping a student for not knowing when it's your job to teach them?
Right, right.
Well, and I think like the jivest.
Yeah. And I think that this thing now is like you get a lot of, and I mean, I've fallen into this a little bit. I always pull myself out of this. You know, there's a lot of assumption like, oh, well, you guys have it easy because you have all this, you know, we had to go find the records. You guys can just pull it up on YouTube immediately. But that doesn't know that it doesn't mean that young folks or any age folks necessarily know. Like we had people telling us, and I know, I mean, we should definitely talk about Wynton here soon because he was such a, you know, a teacher and mentor to both of us at pivotal times, not just us, like basically everybody who's out here playing that's over the age of 4 up to whatever, 3 years younger than Wynton at this point, like he had some influence on, but we had people telling us these kinds of things. And so like, just because the internet can get you something quicker, it doesn't mean the right information. It's almost harder in a way for them because there's such a cloud of, you know, just crap flying around and misinformation, you know, to go in and find the thing. And so I think it's the same thing. We gotta, you know, we've been doing these listening sessions on Tuesday and we'll do a different album. And we, you know, the first week we did John Coltrane Crescent and there was like half the people on the, we had a couple hundred people on there. Half the people were like, man, I never heard this record. This is so awesome. Thanks. And I could have been like, what? You ignorant? How do you not, you know, but it's a cyclical thing too. Like that record was just so, you know, important to me. And at that time, like everybody was talking about it, but this stuff goes in and out and whatever. And like, if we don't talk about it, sometimes just because it's available on YouTube, people don't know to go listen to it.
Right, exactly. And it, man, I mean, there are, all you got to do is go to like a random website where they're selling records. I mean, there's millions of records out there.
Yeah.
Millions, man. How are you going to, it's impossible to know everything.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's impossible. That's why it's so awesome, man. Man, every time I pick this thing up, every time I pick it up, I'm like, okay, what you going to show me today that I can't do?
Oh man, dude.
Like how sad are you going to let me know I am today?
Dude, that was exactly me. I was in at Open Studio today practicing. I'm in there all by myself now. And I'm like, there's nobody I can blame. And you're disturbing me. Now it's just, and I got the pianos all in tune now. And I got nothing to blame on myself. But it's that's the beauty of it. I mean, these are lifelong, you know, things. Okay, so we have a question. This is from Joe, who's one of our longtime dearest members, pianist at Open Studio, and he's asking about Jen. And I should just say you are the newly appointed is it artistic director of the Jazz Education Network, which is
technically
Jen.
Is president.
Oh, president, sorry. Dang, I demoted you there. President of Jen. El Presidente, as they say. President. But this is a really cool thing because I was at the Jen conference in January, your kind of, you know, coronation and stuff. And it's a lot of really good feelings from a lot of the different camps in the education world about you coming on, and folks are really excited. But Joe is asking, because a lot of folks that aren't like, you know, high school band directors or college band directors and stuff don't know exactly what's in it. He's asking, is Jen for people who aren't teachers? Should I join being just a musician?
That's a great question. Jen is not just for teachers. It's for everyone. It literally is a jazz education network. And education is not one-sided. Anyone could be an educator and anyone can be educated. It's basically about sharing the information and hopefully you have the ability to offer some information as you consume information that you haven't known. It's a resource and that's what we're doing. I also want to say that it is not the International Association of Jazz Education. It is not IAJE. It is the JEN organization, Jazz Education Network. And this year, we're super excited because the theme is Beyond the Notes. And it's so important during this time. It's kind of strange. I came up with this theme last year around this time. And I said, basically, we want to deal with jazz and the music, but through the lens of culture, all the other sides of culture. We want to deal with it through film, through dance, through spoken word, through arts, literature, through all of these types of things. So while you're going to hear the music, of course, you're also going to get a glimpse into what has inspired it over several years, so that, you know, we have artists that are putting out records that deal with our times. I mean, there's a lot to talk about this year. You know, I'm wearing this shirt for a reason. I'm tired of seeing people that look like me get killed. I'm tired of it, you know? And I want to make music that addresses that. I'm sick of seeing it. I'm sick of turning on my, you know, turning on the computer or looking at my phone, and there's another one, another person that looks like me dead. You know? Or, you know, this video that just came out the other day of the young lady in Central Park basically telling this guy, oh, I know you're black, so I'm going to call the police and they're going to do something about you. It's time out for that.
Yeah.
You know? And so how do I say that as an artist? Do I get angry? Yes, I get angry because I am angry. You know what I mean? Do I have resolve? Yes. Do I pick up my instrument? Yes. Do I call my friends and my neighbors? Yes. Do I stand up? Yeah, I do all of that. And a lot of times, man, I know I'm kind of going off about this because it's kind of been held inside.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, for the past few days, man. And a lot of times they put musicians or artists in this lane, basically shut up and play.
Yeah.
I'm a citizen of this country, you know, and it hurts me. It pisses me off, it angers me, and it calls me to charge when every time I get ready to leave my crib, I'm thinking I might die. That's real. The wrong word said, the wrong thing, the wrong interaction could have me dead just because I look like this, you know? So how do I say that, you know? And how do I say that to my brothers that don't look like me?
Right.
You know, how do I say that to my, how do I communicate while being angry? How do I communicate while trying to get you to understand my anger? How do I do that? You know, so the reality is some people aren't going to hear you. Some people are going to hear you, but that doesn't mean you don't talk.
Yes.
You don't discuss it. And that's what the arts are about. So that's one thing. COVID-19, the depression that's coming out of this, you know, the fact that people can't rely on their bank accounts right now, you know, in a system where the vast majority of what we do is tied to something that is economic.
Yeah.
Man, think about the world we live in. It's like the first thing that people talk about when they want to create something typically is, oh, how much is this going to get me paid?
Right.
That's the worst place to create from.
Right.
How am I going to monetize it? Man, forget that for a minute.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because the reality is, I don't care how rich you are, you're probably a little less richer unless you're using this to be jive, which is another another story.
Well, people's true characters, I always say, comes out in a crisis. This doesn't, people can't be like, oh, I lost my mind during COVID. I went looting and I went and did a scam and got some. No, that's you. Exactly. That was you. That, don't blame that on COVID.
And that's how you are. Yeah, man.
I just want to say, like, I really appreciate you speaking out on these issues so much, because especially at this time, a lot of people be like, well, don't, you know, wait for the right time or whatever. It's like, no, this stuff is happening now. Like, these fools can't even take time off for a pandemic. No. You know, it was like, for a while, it was like, okay, people weren't going out, there's not pollution, the pandemic is horrible, but people are staying in, at least there's a few good things happening. I mean, you have this, and I actually think it's even more incumbent upon not, you know, people that look like this to speak out about this, because and people that look like that woman in Central Park, other white women, Karens, whatever we want to call them, they need to be like, no, this is wrong. That's not me. And I'm not going to wait for somebody who's the victim or a potential victim of that That's for us to, I mean, for us all to speak up. But I mean, this has to make us mad as humans. Not, I live in New York. I'm an American. I'm white. I'm black. I'm a human. And this is about humanity. And at a time when, you know, you see people, it's hard because you see people doing the greatest of things, you know, in a crisis, because that's their true thing coming out. And then you see the worst in people. And it's like, I mean, what about when some good Samaritan doesn't have a camera on? We don't even hear about that. I mean, you thank God there's a camera for some of these, just so that, I mean, otherwise people, you know, we're fickle. The society is like, if there's no video and audio, it's like it didn't happen at this point.
Right.
And
yeah, I just want to address one thing I'm saying on the comments. It's Mr. Jellington, is I feel shameful when I see those awful things happening. You don't have to feel shame. You know, I've heard people say that. You don't have to feel shame at being, you know, if you're a white person, you're gonna say, I'm embarrassed to be white, because that's not cool either.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's not cool. Shameful as a human being, I get that. And there is only one race. You know, race is a false construct.
Yep. Absolutely.
It's a false construct. You know, yeah, we look, you know, different, but we're the same, man.
Yeah.
We are. How is it the same?
How is it that musicians, and I mean, I don't want to toot our horn too much, but I've seen like musicians, or I shouldn't say just musicians, people in the arts do, I think we need to speak out, because we understand that on an intuitive and just base level in a way that I think is rare. I mean, I think that you see that in religion, you know, when religion is done correctly, you see that as well. But I think that artists in general, you know, because we have to channel that humanity. We can't make white music or Aryan music or black music truly. I mean, like, if we're not in touch with a human thing, but I think that that is something that we excel in understanding.
Right. Well, here's the thing, man. The reason why artists are the way that we are is because, and I'll go as far as to say, is deeply religious people. Not deeply religious, deeply spiritual
people. Spiritual, absolutely.
Deeply spiritual people, artists. What we have done is we have gone so deep into our humanity in a certain lane. For musicians, it's sound, right? For those that create visual artists, it's the vision, it's the sight. What can you say? We've gone so far into that separation is not an option at a certain point. You know, like for an artist to, it always kind of freaked me out where somebody can say, like somebody like what was his name? A great classical composer. He wrote The Ring Cycle. I don't know why.
Wagner.
Wagner.
Yeah.
Wagner. Like, people say Wagner was such a racist. Like, that always confused me. It's like, man, if you have that deeply of an emotional connection to a diminished chord, how could you be racist?
Right.
You know, and I think some of it is probably just a matter of, this is where I live and this is all I see, so that's all I know. But now in 2020, well, I'll say 2019, the world is big and we've seen so much. It's all out there. And so to me now, to be a racist or to not see a certain level of humanity in some other person, is there's no excuse for it anymore.
Right.
Like, how do you not see it? Like, everything is right there for you in your face. You know?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Absolutely. Absolutely. There was something somebody was asking. I wanted just to catch.
There was a trumpet question earlier.
Oh, yeah. I let that fly by?
Yeah, I don't know. You know, I got to take care of the trumpets.
I know. I know you guys like to stick together, the brass department.
Yeah, I'm still in there to look.
Oh, it was about, well, what about this one? How about here? I know this is somebody you're fond of. Gerald asks, what is the greatest lesson that Prof taught you? And you can let folks know who Prof was.
The greatest lesson that Prof taught me. Prof is William Fielder. He taught at Rutgers University for 25, 30 years before he passed away. I was one of his last students. He has taught in varying universities over the years. He taught Wynton Marsalis when he was a teenager. He taught Terrell Stafford. He taught Terrence Blanchard. Pretty much, you know, there is there would be a huge gap in the trumpet lineage from the 80s if Prof didn't exist. The most important thing he taught me is probably the attention to one specific aspect of your playing. Mm-hmm. Like, I worked on this for a year. Literally that only for a year, bro. Mm-hmm. And people will hear that, they're like, oh, that's not profound. But usually people play a mouthpiece that sounds like this. There's air in it. Now, for an entire year, I spent on this mouthpiece trying to eliminate the air, because if you get absolute resonance on the mouthpiece, you get absolute resonance on your horn. See what I mean? So I would have to say that the attention it takes to deal with one thing is what I learned most from him.
Man, that's great stuff. Yeah, actually, I had a great teacher when I was in high school that it was a similar, well, you know, we're never doing anything embouchure or blowing wise on piano, but it was the similar kind of zen of the piano, you know, one thing. So right. Was this the one you were talking about, the who are your favorite top three trumpet players?
My favorite, favorite top three trumpet players has to go, well, I have to put Miles over here. Mm. You know, happy birthday, Miles, yesterday.
That's right. East St. Louis finest.
Yeah, Miles is over here. Miles is a different story for me. I have my jazz trumpet Holy Trinity, which is Freddie Hubbard, Woody Shaw, and Clifford Brown. Clifford Brown I like because of his vibrant tone, the buoyancy that he plays with his articulation. Like, I love that and how clean it is. Mm-hmm. Freddie Hubbard, I like just the, for lack of a better way of saying it, just that kind of aggressive kind of way of playing linearly and all over the horn, and just the bravura he brings to the table. Like, you know, it's a trumpet when Freddie is playing.
Oh, yeah.
I like Woody Shaw. Believe it or not, I like Woody Shaw most because of the way that he plays in the time over the waltz. Mm. Like, his time is impeccable. Mm. Like, we talk about tension and resolution regarding harmonic structures all the time, but we hardly ever talk about tension and resolution regarding rhythm. Mm. And Woody Shaw, check it out in a Capricornian way. The way that he uses time to make things tense is just amazing to me. And obviously the way he plays over fourths, I really love that. So those are my jazz trumpet Holy Trinities. Now, just trumpet as a whole, that's another thing. Maurice Andre is one of my favorite trumpet players. Phil Smith has my favorite trumpet sound, period, of anyone. Phil Smith, former principal trumpet player of the New York Philharmonic. He has my favorite sound. And then just all-around trumpet playing, my favorite all-around living trumpeter is Hakan Hardenberger. Mm. He's ridiculous. That's all I'm going to say.
All right, so I got a quick trumpet question for you. I just remembered. So we did, on our Tuesday night listening sesh, we did one of the weeks we did Miles Davis, My Funny Valentine. Yeah. And, you know, that's a record that, I mean, that was kind of like the turning point for me when I first heard that, like, where I was like, I want to do that, whatever that is. I want to be part of that. That was that record for me because of Herbie, and then eventually because of everybody. But I was listening to, I mean, this is like 1983, I guess, or so. And Herbie Hancock Rocket was on the radio, was on MTV. And I love that. And my dad was like, who is that? And I was like, man, this is Herbie Hancock. You don't know. And he's like, oh, I know Herbie Hancock. He's like, I think I have a Miles record with him playing on it. I was like, what? No. I was like, that's not possible. He's like, yeah. And so he played me that record. And so I've always loved that record. But anyway, we're listening to it. We're having this discussion about it. We're like breaking it down, me and Adam, you know. And I said something that turned out to be kind of controversial. It was, and I basically just said, you know, one thing about that record of all the Miles recordings that I know and love, I was like, he kind of hit a very high level of trumpet technique on that record. I just sort of basically said he was at the peak of his game technique wise, and that he was not necessarily known as a great. Yeah. And that's the other half of the concert right there. That's the other half. But I mean, was I wrong with that? I was just basically saying, like, you know, he was not known as the greatest trumpet player. He was certainly a great trumpet player, but technically, for the way we normally evaluate, but on that record, he hit a very high level of trumpet technique.
I think it's important when you talk about Miles, is Miles can be in the trumpet conversation, but Miles was not, like, the trumpet was like a microphone for him.
Yeah.
Like, Miles was, that just happened to be what he played.
Right.
And I think he respected the trumpet. Actually, I know he respected the trumpet, because you can't do what he did without respecting it.
Yeah.
But ultimately, the trumpet was the vehicle for him to navigate sound. Mm. Like, Miles was like a conductor, man. Like, if you hear how he plays, he always comes in at the right time. Mm. He always directs traffic properly. He's the ultimate. Yeah. And so what you're hearing is just, it just happened to be in that particular time period in his playing, he was at a very high level. But to me, Miles's best playing technically was in the 70s. Mm. Like, if you listen to Miles, like, on certain live recordings from the 70s, early 70s, it's, man, it's stupid.
Fillmore, he is.
Yeah,
he's throwing down on that. Yeah.
It's ridiculous, man. Now, at that time, he wasn't drinking or smoking or taking any drugs or doing any of that. Mm-hmm. So he was very focused on his health.
Right.
So, you know, you hear that in his playing. And you could hear when he wasn't so focused on his health. You can hear You can hear it on the records.
Right.
But when I think about Miles, I honestly don't think about the trumpet.
Right.
Like, it's just so, I mean, it's in its own space of time. And it's like, you can't really just say, wow, that's the trumpet.
Yeah.
Like, it's Miles.
Yeah. And that's what I was kind of, I wasn't super eloquent about. That's what I was kind of trying to say, is that, like, he transcended just the trumpet or to technique to be like, oh my God, first of all, he was able to express. I always look at the ultimate level of technique on any instrument. I mean, above trumpet specific or piano or saxophone, the higher level of music technique is just being able to express yourself. And nobody could do that better than Miles. And like you say, when you include his conducting and his band leading and choosing the players. And I mean, like, he knew how to come in and cut off Herbie, which should be a bad thing, but it turned out to be a good thing, because it, like, pulled the architecture of the tune together. You know, I mean, he was a master of the moment, and you know, so much more above just trumpet playing. But
I mean, that's his thing. You know, I like to hear Ty Barkin talk about Miles, because Miles played at the Keystone Corner a lot, apparently.
Right.
And he would say that when they hung out, that it was basically a listening lesson. He said Miles was the greatest listener. Mm. He'd ever been around in his life. Like, Miles just heard everything. Mm-hmm. Just heard everything.
Yeah.
And so when I listen to Miles's band from any time period, it's like, oh, it makes so much sense.
Yeah, totally. I mean, the Plug Nickel, especially all those, like, the extent. I mean, when I first heard Plug Nickel, it was one CD, and now they've got, you know, all the stuff. But to me, during that period, like, his listening was so, like, I know a lot of people are like, man, he was playing sloppy or what, but I'm like, his listening was so acute to what Wayne was playing and Herbie and everybody. Like, when he would come back in, like, he was not mirroring what they're playing, but, like, weaving it in a way that was so advanced. He was, like, taking it and just doing all this stuff. I mean, he was hearing all that stuff.
Well, you know the story of that record, right?
Not really, no.
Check this out, man. So I was on the bus with Herbie and Wayne, and we were heading somewhere, and I was just asking them questions, man. And I said, man, y'all got to tell me about the Plug Nickel recording. And they both started laughing. Hmm. And I'm like, why is this funny? And so here's the story. Herbie and Tony, Herbie Hancock, Tony Williams, they were in the back of a car heading to the gig. And Herbie looked at Tony and said, "Hey man, I'm kind of bored at what we're playing." And Tony said, "Yeah, we need to do something." And so Tony said, "I know, I got it. Why don't we just play everything backwards or play everything the opposite of what our instincts are? So if we have an instinct to play something high, play it low. If we have an instinct to play something fast, play it slow." So basically it was opposite day on the stage. And so Herbie was like, "Yeah." And I asked Wayne, I said, "Wayne, what did you think?" And Herbie was like, "We didn't tell Wayne because we knew Wayne wasn't going to know."
Oh, that's great.
So that was the whole gig, man.
Yeah.
They literally played the opposite of their instincts.
Wow. Well, it still works. It works even more. I mean,
yeah, because it works because it's still from the same intention.
Right. 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 Well, that was the thing we were talking about, you know, on the My Funny Valentine. Apparently there was the backstory on that gig at Philharmonic Hall was like they were right before they went on stage, Miles told them or his manager or something was like, "Oh yeah, this is a benefit concert. No one's getting paid." And they were all pissed off and they went out and played this incredible, you know. I mean, even on like some people are like, "Well, on Four and More, they sound angry." I'm like, "No, they're just playing fast. Those are just the fast tunes from the record."
Yeah.
You know, but I mean, you can hear like the way they're playing and interacting and stuff. And like, to me, George Coleman is such a like driver of a lot of the kind of, you know, thematic and the architecture, the harmonic stuff, obviously. But like that you hear on both albums. But I think it's a cool thing that, you know, that's some professionalism there too. They're pissed off. They're like, "Well, we're out here. We're not gonna half step it. We're gonna go double. We're gonna go dopio on the quality level since we're not getting paid."
Right, dig it.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, integrity, man.
So why don't we just take a couple more quick questions here? We're already right at an hour, and I know you got the baby to go back to and dinner and all that stuff. And man, we appreciate your time. Folks are loving it. But while we do these quick ones, were you ever afraid to perform on stage? And if so, how did you get over it?
Yes. I was actually, believe it or not, I'm a shy person. When I was a kid, man, I was afraid to go to school. Because I was afraid people are going to laugh or they're going to do whatever. I'm a very shy kid. The way that I got over being shy was two things. One, it was either not play because I was shy or get over it. So I made the choice. It sounds funny, but
sink or swim.
Yeah, sink or swim. It's like, okay, I like playing this thing, so I better get over this whole notion of being shy.
Yeah.
Because there's no option. And the other thing is,
okay, let me just ask you real quick, Sean. Is because it's the trumpet and it's always associated with being an extrovert's instrument, did that specifically help you, you think? Was that part of the thought?
No.
Okay.
No, believe it or not. The trumpet can be an extrovert's instrument. I think the trumpet, you know, a lot of people here, they talk about the trumpet ego. I think it's because we have to psych ourselves so much up before we get on stage because we don't know half the time if it's going to come out or not.
Right.
That we just hype ourselves up. But the other side of the question is, the more you do something, the more comfortable you get.
Mm-hmm.
It's like for me, I really got into, during COVID-19, I got into making different versions of a red sauce because I'm really into Italian food.
Mm.
So I started cooking stuff, and now, you know, at the beginning, it was like being really anal about the recipe. Now I'm like, I don't look at the recipe at all. I just know what I want it to be.
Oh, he's getting cocky now. He's like, bam.
Bro, I got you now.
Yeah, man.
I got you on it now. And so that's what happens. The more you do something, the more you perform and you realize that your brain is not going to crack open and these ooze out of your head because you missed a note.
Right.
You're cool.
Yep. Absolutely.
But even now for me, the flip side of it now is like when I come on the stage, I feel a deep responsibility to the people that are there. Like I actually, in my mind, I consider that I have a gigantic set of keys, and every single person that walks in the door is in handcuffs.
Mm.
And the only way that those handcuffs could be let loose is I take my sound and unlock those handcuffs. Mm. Like, I have the keys and my notes are the keys that will unlock the chains that people walk into the venue with. Wow. So that's kind of how I think now.
All right. Is it cool if I steal that one? I mean, just because of the pandemic and everything. I like that. I like that visualization. I like that.
Take it, man. But that's how I feel. I literally feel that way. It's like my responsibility is, you know, people are coming. They're spending $50, $60 of their hard-earned money.
Yep.
On a Friday, a Saturday, a Thursday, whatever it is. Chances are they might not even be able to afford it. But they're like, I need this. I got to go out. Or maybe they're on their first date and they're like, man, I got to really impress this person.
Right.
You know, so what am I going to do if I sound like Boo Boo the Fool on the stage? You know, that's going to
ruin Bobo the Clown.
You know what I mean?
Man, so, I always get most nervous about the, like, when you see the young couple and, like you said, and then you know they're on their first date, because you, it's like, that's a lot of responsibility for us to, like, you know, if you're thinking about all up, you're like, you got to put a nice ballad in, you got to nail it. You can mess up, you know, this guy or this young lady's, their whole chances together. Like, man, our first date didn't work out. We used to start that sad jazz band. Right.
You know, that actually leads me to another point, bro. The one of the main reasons that I'm not worried about stage fright or any of that right now is because this is something that Ralph Bowen, who is an amazing tenor saxophonist, told me. He's my professor at Rutgers. He said that if on a scale from 1 to 10, you're a 7, you'll never go below a 6. So the thing that you need to do is work on your general level every day. Mm. So that if you're at level 8, you never go below a 7. Mm. So that gives me the confidence when I go on the stage that when I see a couple out in the audience, it's like, oh, I know the ballad for them.
Right.
And so even if it's not my greatest performance, it's still going to be pretty good.
Yeah.
Because I've worked up to that level.
Yeah. You're in that pro range. You're in that pro range, you know.
Yeah, and it's attainable. It's attainable. Look, yep. I'm no different from anybody else. I'm from Warren, Ohio. You know, I'm not some special person. The only thing that's different from me and anybody else is I put in a ton of work. Mm. That's it.
Yeah. But that's, you know what? That's, I mean, we couldn't name a musician that we both know and respect and play with. I mean, even Warren Wolf, our good friend, who we're always having fun with in season, and we all secretly are jealous of, because he's, you know, he's a savant for music and every instrument.
Right.
But even someone as supremely talented as him has put, I mean, he probably put in more work than all of them. I mean,
you know,
stories about his dad having him in there practicing and stuff, multiple
hours,
instruments. Hours.
Hour upon hour every day.
Yeah, and he seems like the kind of cat that was going to be bad no matter what. So even he put the time in, you know. All right, let's do one more question and then cut out here. Okay, so this one is, well, first, George says trumpet players equals the best joke tellers. That's not always true, but sometimes. Sometimes, you know. Let's see. Luigi says, can you guys give me some tips to get comfortable playing up-tempo? I've been learning Erigen, and I've hit a wall to improvise over it.
Okay. That's a great point. The hardest thing about doing anything is actually doing it. Hmm. So if you want to play high, you got to play high. If you want to play fast, you got to play fast. That sounds very like simple, but it's actually that simple. Hmm. The thing that's hard about it is the patience that it takes for.
We lost Sean.
That it takes for you to.
There he is. We lost you for just a second. Yeah, maybe say your last sentence, because it looked like it was about to be profound.
Yeah, sorry, somebody's gone. The hardest thing for you to realize is for people to take is that their mind typically is ahead of their body. Mm. And this is what happens in development. You reach plateaus. And those plateaus happen, in my view, because the mind is already advancing past what the physical advancing past your physical limitations. So I would say, remind yourself to be patient. If you're playing a scale or any exercise at a quarter note equals 120, make sure you can play it in all of those keys at 120. Okay. Then little by little, click up the metronome, get used to the physical relationship that your mind has with your brain. Okay. And then you get faster, And then you start to apply those things to the tunes you're working on. I'll tell you right up front, the only reason that I can play over Cherokee or the Giant Steps or any of those tunes that require faster tempos is because I've worked out a ton of ideas over them. A ton, you know, and I just shedded. I shedded Giant Steps for like an entire year. And I wrote out solos over it, and I would play it at varying tempos until Giant Steps was just like, oh, I know that like the back of my hand. Oh, play it in seven. Oh, play it in five. Play it. You have to exhaust all possibilities, right? It's like the relationship you have with your name. If somebody said to you, what's your name? You just, oh, my name's that. But at one point in time, you had to remember that. Or your, or any speech or anything that you have to spend a great deal of time with in order to become intimate with it. You know, you have to become intimate with your instrument so that you're able to play at a high tempo and it doesn't seem like anything. So, so if I pick up my horn, like I wasn't even thinking. It was just like, oh, Cherokee, play some stuff this Cherokee. And so I have an entire vault in my mind of Cherokee. You know what I mean?
Yep.
But that vault changes when I'm playing with people in the band. I open the vault and it's like, okay, this can work, that can work, this can work, because I'm playing with these cats. But that takes doing it. You know? It's nothing, it's, there's nothing hard about doing anything. There's nothing hard. Hard doesn't exist in the world. Except in one instance, follow through.
Right.
The hardest thing about doing anything is follow through.
Yep.
Because the reality is, most things, once you start doing them, you can't do them. If that was the case, everything would be hard. Oh, it's hard to type. Oh, it's hard to cook ramen noodles. Oh, it's hard to plug a light bulb in. Oh, it's hard to do. You see what I'm saying? Now, granted, some things take more time than others.
Yep.
But if we got caught up into how difficult something is, we wouldn't do anything. Think about how difficult it is for your body to move. Think about the communication that your brain has to go through in order to literally talk to every part of your body so that it can get from this place to that place. If you thought about that every time you got ready to walk, you wouldn't go anywhere.
I mean, we learned all the really hard stuff when we were infants, you know?
Exactly.
This stuff is easy compared to that.
Yeah.
It's just a couple chord changes.
You have to free your mind. Like you have to, you have to get out of your head and stop thinking that something is difficult. You know, that, and it leads me back to another point when I was growing up in that church. They would say you have to be like a child in order to, or have the mind of a child in order to enter the kingdom of heaven.
Yep.
And what does that mean to me? A kid doesn't know how hard anything is.
Right.
The only thing they care about is doing it.
Yeah. They got the wonderment. They got the possibilities. Yeah.
Yeah. And so that's how you have to do with playing fast.
Yep.
Get a metronome. Now, now some basic stuff. I know I'm going over, man, but this is really passionate to me because I understand like how frustrating it could be when doing this. You have to have an intimate relationship with the metronome. The metronome is your honesty. So put that on, work it up. If you're a trumpet player, bang down your vowels like so that there's muscle memory there. Hopefully you can hear my vowels.
Yep, you can hear them.
Right? And so you get that muscle memory, make sure it's clean, make sure you're honest about how clean it is, and then just start working it up little by little, little by little. Maybe it takes you a month. Maybe it takes you a year. Maybe it takes you 3 years. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, that's great stuff and has been proven over and over again. That's not just like, man, if we try this, this is stuff that works. And I would just echo one thing that you said, just to amplify on it, about when you were talking about giant steps and, you know, you were saying you took a year just to get familiar with the tune. Forget about creating something new. A lot of times, you know, young players or any players are like, man, how do you play fast and play your best stuff? You're not going to at the beginning. No, you got to get, you just have to get comfortable playing fast. Play, you're going to play all your best stuff, slow, medium, at these different tempos. It'll translate. You're the same person. It's like during that year, I would imagine you're getting comfortable with this, but you're getting comfortable with your ears being able to move at that tempo. It's like running, you know. Sean and I are both runners, and you know, I think we haven't amazed anyone in the running world yet as far as records, but we've probably both amazed ourselves, most importantly, you know.
Bro.
And you know, it's like
if you would have told me 5 years ago that I would run 15 miles, I would laugh at you.
Right. And then all of a sudden it's like, notice Sean said 5 years. He didn't say 5 days ago or 5 months ago. You know, it's like this stuff takes time, but then the time goes by and it's like, wow, you're there, you're running the 15 miles. And I mean, same for me. I was like a half marathon. I mean, I was just like, what? No, I'm not going to, I could drive a half marathon if I got enough gas. That's not a problem. But
the most fun thing about being able to do anything is learning how to do it.
Yes. I love that. It's the process. It's the process. It's the not process. Like once you get there, getting to the 15 miles, running the 15 miles is whatever. It was that journey. It's the journey. Yeah.
That's the most fun thing ever. It's just the process is what's important. Like I'm actually enjoying this process. COVID-19, I'm enjoying it. I'm learning so much about myself, good and bad. Mm. Right? I'm learning about my family. I'm learning about stuff that I have not really gotten into as much as I should have over there, like Pro Tools and things.
Yeah.
You know, I've relied on engineers to
I know. But now every musician's having to become an engineer now. They're all laughing at us like, you see what we got to go through.
Yeah, they laughing now until we can all do it.
That's right. We're going to be like, oh, we're good. I did it at the crib.
Yeah. We're like, no, that's cool. I actually know what I want on my own record. Thanks.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
So that's it. Just be comfortable with the process and be patient. Like Rome wasn't built in a day, but that's why it's Rome.
That's right. That's right. I love that. And I love being the patience and loving the process. What's great about that is once you're not like, oh, let me quick get this over with so I can play fast. You're having so much fun getting that metronome a couple clips up each day. You get to the point where like, I don't want it to end. This is a fun year with giant steps.
And bro, forget playing fast. What about this? Holding a note out so that it's not out of tune and you crescendo and decrescendo without it being distorted.
Yeah.
That right there is patience. And that's required every day. Every day.
Yeah. Absolutely. Truth. Truth is spoken. There we go. Sean Jones, thank you so much. This has been a pleasure. It's always a pleasure talking with you and getting a chance to hang and catch up. And I know I'm just reading the comments here. Folks really enjoyed it. So
thank you, bro.
Yeah, big clapping to Sean. Live at the Bistro. I love that. Is that your officially last record or you got something after that?
That's the official last one. There's other stuff, but that's the official last one. I have 3 records in the queue. So
I knew you had some stuff. You not only the other baby that you already pulled out the oven, you got some other musical babies in the oven as well.
Yes, a few of them ready to go.
but if you guys get a chance, if you haven't heard Live at the Bistro, check that out. Like I say, I was at the gig, and you know, it's a beautifully recorded album, and it really captures what was a very special weekend. And it's just a cool record. Kaleidoscope's another one I like. But check out Sean's stuff if you want to. You know, his stuff runs the gamut of humanity, just like he is as a person. So there's something for if you want to chill, if you want to turn your ear in. There's a lot of great stuff out there available. And
thank you, bro. I can't wait to play with you again, man.
Oh, it's man, it's going to be. I know. Oh, absolutely. Me too, man. And I'm going to be ready. We get the whole package. That's always fun. Wait, let me just throw the picture up one more time so we can, case cats came late later. Let me see. See, normally Rachel's here. She'll be like, okay. So yeah, this is what we're talking about. We can't wait to play together again. This is Pittsburgh, man. I mean, the audience is just going to be a little more spread out. That's the only difference. Everything else will be the same.
And shout out to all my friends from Pittsburgh. Tanya, I see you on there. All my friends from Pittsburgh have chimed in. Dr. Gage, my man, Fran, you know, all of my good friends on here. Frederico, if I'm missing you, I'm sorry. Good to see y'all.
Yeah. Cool. All right. Well, everybody, we're gonna end it here. Thanks, Sean. Peace to everyone. Have a great evening. We'll see you on the next one.
Be well.